Tell us your name.
Yeah, my name is Moses Kilolo, and I am the Managing Editor of Jalada Africa. Jalada is a pan-African collective, and it was started like 2 years ago. It's going to be 2 years next week, so it's our second anniversary in a week's time. Yeah, and we have members from around Africa. We have people in South Africa, we have people in Kenya, we have people in Uganda, people in Nigeria. And we work together as a team, and we get our different strengths, and we make sure that when we have a project like the upcoming language issue, we are all involved since the moment it's announced through to when it's published. Everybody is involved with talking to people about submissions, talking to friends who can submit, spreading word about the call out. And then when it comes to the editorial process, we also work together. We divide the work amongst ourselves, we read that, and we select what's going to be the final selection for the anthology. And then we all edit together. It's a very rigorous editorial process. And I think that's one of our strengths. And that's what we're trying to cultivate, working with the writers to make sure that whatever goes out is the best it can be. Yeah, and the writers are involved in every stage.
How do you develop the theme? So this theme is language. How is that decided?
Basically, we discuss about it. We have an online forum where we discuss most things, because being based in different places, we can't physically meet most of the time. Most of the people are in Nairobi, so we meet up, but it's just food. Okay, I was supposed to say drinking beer. Yeah, but we discuss via email. We have a forum that's very active. So if someone wants us to do a certain project, they're just going to write to the collective, and people are going to discuss about it, and we decide we're going to go with this or that. And then when the decision is made, then we formulate and we find a way of approaching the project.
So in this case, how are you thinking about language? Is it a very broad topic that can be interpreted, or do you have particular ideas of what you're looking for?
We normally let the writers, we don't like giving the writers instructions of how they're going to interpret things, but we give a guideline so that people will not just write
anything, right?
Yeah, so for the language issue, we asked writers to do either of three things. One, they can write in their language and then translate that to English, because English is the common language.
The reach is bigger.
Yeah. And two, they could also use language as the theme in what they want to do. Or they could use language as a character. Just, we give people options on how they would want to approach that. Yeah.
And we're also thinking about maybe translating the pieces that are sent in to French as well, just so we can see how a piece can travel in different languages, what the reach would be, so that we are not just concentrated on Anglophone.
And are the authors are doing their own translation, or sometimes meaning can be really distorted through translation.
Exactly.
So
we got one submission and we're like, we don't know what the original reads like, but the English is crap.
Yeah.
Now we want to find out if we can find, because we don't speak most languages, so we have to find people who can read these languages. And the advantage of social media is that writers are connected, and we keep talking to people in Nigeria. Yeah. We have people in Zimbabwe that we are friends with, and we keep talking to them. So if we get something, say, in Shona, and we have a friend who is Shona, they can either read it or they can, they can connect us to someone who can read that. And we get to read everything that we receive.
But it's great that you're giving the authors the benefit of the doubt instead of just saying, this is crap in English, so it must be crap in whatever language.
Yeah. We know people can be very good in one language, and translating to English can be a challenge.
Can be very difficult, yeah. Meanings can be so different depending on what's possible to express in a language. So how did you become interested in this kind of publishing? Because you said you're working full-time in some other area, so this is a passion for you?
For me? Jalada is full-time for me at the moment.
Okay.
He's the man who's doing a lot of the work, and he's doing a fantastic job.
Yeah, so when we started as a collective. It's meant to be everybody is involved, and that's what happens. But you know, you can't leave everybody to make. There has to be a reference point. There has to be, you know, someone who can, you know, gather people together. And I am that guy.
The coordinator.
It's not easy, but coordinating stuff can be hard. But with the cooperation that we have from each member, it makes it very easy to work with everyone. And I'm encouraged by the support that I receive. Like, I would receive a call from Nigeria, so what are we doing? You know, it's interesting how enthusiastic each member is. Yeah. But when we started, it was, we actually just wanted to publish the collective, the members. But after the first anthology, there was so much interest from around Africa. People were writing, even submitting to the anthologies that we had already, you know, published. And from there, we thought, let's ask people to submit. So we allowed other people to send to the second anthology. And it's grown. Yeah, it's grown so big.
I guess it's like a question. I think we were having a session the other day, and people were asking, so yeah, there's all this writing, but then where are we going to take it? You know. So I think it's just like expanding the whole publishing, trying to, you know, establish spaces for ourselves as well that are more accessible to people who don't have the access that, you know, is there for traditional publishers. And yeah.
Have you found it easy at all? I mean, I'm wondering about this collective model for publishing, because publishing is encountering challenges, you know, regardless of, I mean, in the U.S. anyway, it's not a profitable business. So I wonder about starting new efforts and whether you feel that this collective model might be a way forward for publishing in general. And where's the business model? Is that emerging for you? Can you be our visionary for where publishing needs to go?
We'll see where it goes, and then you
we'll follow
Let's
you.
Try and see. Yeah. Let's see how far it goes.
Yeah.
Do you want to come over?
Yes.
Come on. This is informal. We're just talking.
Yeah. You can sit here.
Huh?
You can sit here. That question would be more appropriate for Anne.
Yes, we were talking about this last night. I'd love to hear more of your thoughts, because you were mentioning the collective as a model moving forward.
No, it's just one of the things I like thinking about. It's not really a fully formed, and this is the way we are going to fix publishing, guys. It's nothing remotely like that, but it's just, I mean, yeah, you can't just sell books anymore. Like, you can't just, half the bookshops in Nairobi closed, you know?
Yeah.
And the other half are far too expensive for the average person. I still buy my books for 50 bob
in
town. Yeah, there's a guy downtown that, you know, for some reason has fantastic books, and you just go and you buy from him. So you have to kind of find other ways. So there's, I mean, I think there's, we were discussing over Jalada so many different ideas, whether it's, I mean, the worst possible option, in my opinion, is like an advertising model like most websites. Kind of sucks, because then you have to see to them.
Coca-Cola.
Yeah. There's money and there's opportunities more so, but it's not really the best. It might be more of a subscriber model. Maybe there's a free, like a lot of music things, maybe it's free for most people, but then like, or a lot of magazines do that as well online. A lot of free content, but then subscribers get all these fantastic exclusive things that only if you pay 99 cents a month, whatever. Or maybe the collective model, where instead of trying so hard to get money from outside, which I think might be really cool, working more like a cooperative almost, where you support each other, bring in funds together. If you want to run a festival, yes, you can apply for funding, but you can also just raise it amongst yourselves. If there's a profit made from something, whatever the case may be, maybe you're teaching classes, or we talked briefly about how Jalada not only has great writers, there's a lot of really, really good editors, and people are doing fantastic editorial work. Maybe as part of the collective, you're sending out editors to do work.
Freelancing,
but like as a set group of editors where people know if you go to Jalada, they'll have 10 editors, and Jalada make 10%, but they're also the editors getting paid. So you're not really looking at different ways where you're not so statically set on just, we have to sell books because that doesn't work. You have to kind of think of other ways. I'm thinking maybe something like a cooperative type thing, and you just, I mean, ultimately the whole collective idea was pushing each other's work and creating a space. And so if that is the ultimate focus, like, why not just keep focusing on that and just keep doing that in whatever way possible, you know?
To me, it seems like the strength in that is that you all bring different resources.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it prevents the us-them dynamic of, like, artists versus publishers, or, like my parents are artists and they don't know how to market themselves.
Yeah.
You know, they're lost when it comes to figuring out how to sell their work. So this way, the people who have more of the business side of the thinking, like, you can share your ideas and things can grow out of the group. Seems really encouraging.
I think that's our greatest strength, because I'm not a very business oriented person. Like me, I just want to go out there and find writers and find stories and make sure that the editorial process is gone through. There are other members of the collective that are very good with the business side of the collective, and then we talk with Anne all the time. She's very good with that, and we talk all the time about it, and we're formulating ways of how we're going to push it forward.
It's brilliant because it's not exploitative, you know. I often feel like we're battling with our publisher because they won't allow us to give certain material away for free because they're trying to make money, and they have to make money, they're a business, but then we don't have any negotiating power with that, you know. So it's a lot less flexible in terms of what we're able to do and how we're able to grow.
I mean, I think Moses definitely nailed it on the head. Everyone has something they bring to the table.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's, like, one of the reasons I know, because the first few issues of Jalada, I led the first one, so they helped with the second.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a really long discussion about who can, like, actually run this thing. One of the reasons Moses was, like, he volunteered, but he also was selected, because more than just, like, ideas, very good at, like, okay, these are all the concepts that we have. This is the way we'll implement them. And, like, let's actually do this stuff, and let's bring the people together and email whoever. Or you want to, I mean, we were talking about the language issue, and I was like, oh, it'd be so cool if Googie would write something. Da, 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 da.
Yeah.
And he's like, okay, cool. 2 days later, he's emailing Mukoma, like, we're coming to the festival, da, 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 and a conversation was started. And there was, and people like Jackie, who are not just doing fantastic writing, but also do really good editing. And, like, when you work with people who have such sharp eyes, and such, and their content as well is so strong, you just, like, you have so many different perspectives. There's guys who do a lot of good marketing and are always on Facebook and Twitter and stuff, which I'm terrible at, and they're just, like, always pushing things through. The issue is out at midnight, they're tweeting at midnight, at 1 minute past midnight, to make sure that everybody knows that it's out.
Especially Richard,
exactly. Yeah. Great, like, Richard Ali has, like, fantastic publishing experience, and we're meeting this week, and he's gonna bring a whole, like, other perspective to things that we've probably not even thought about. So it's
clear you have a lot of respect for each other, and I'm just wondering, because in a group one of the challenges can be if there's some sort of disagreement on how to move forward, how is that handled, or have you not encountered that?
In
a group of people, there's going to be disagreements.
But again, it's those disagreements that also push us forward, because everybody gets to be very spoken, you know.
Yeah.
And by that, we also learn how to deal with each other. We also learn how to, you know, to be able to approach each other. We know what Ndinda doesn't like. I know what Anne doesn't like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, by, you know, if we pretended everything was perfect, I would never know what Anne, you know, doesn't like, or how she approaches her work. And being creatives, we have very different ways of approaching how we work. And by disagreeing, by, you know, facing some obstacles, then we know how to deal with each other and the respect grows, and it, you know.
And I also think that, like, when we set up the communication, and like we have an email group where anything can be said openly, and I think it's easier to deal with issues when, you know, like if, say, Moses does something that, you know, one person doesn't like everybody is always free to talk about it, you know, and I think that helps to deal with a lot of, like, we know that things won't explode at some point because we know people are being very open even when, you know, they're not being silent about things that they don't like.
Impressive. I mean, I'm jealous. I just want to, no, really. I just want to tell you all how much I admire what you're doing. And I think it's really special that you're building this yourselves.
Yeah. I think it's also shocking to us that how people are really, like, we just started this thing for, like, just something for our work, and everybody is just
like a random fiction workshop. Oh, we hang out. It'd be so cool if you did a website. Yeah, it'd be cool. We'll do it this time. It was like such a, like, even the name, I can't remember who said it. Like, Jalada means, library. Oh, cool. It was such a, like, a casual thing. And then within third issue? Like getting such like feedback, like, oh, you're doing such interesting work. We're like, oh, okay.
Well, you know, in the beginning it looks like an accident, and later on it was meant to be, you know.
We went to Port Harcourt and it was shocking how many people knew about Jalada and how they wanted to give, like, to send their work to Jalada, and now coming here.
I mean, I was writing a reference for someone as an associate editor at Jalada, and I'm like, hey, like, you're gonna apply for something with my rep, like, that's it's insane.
It's shocking to us also how, and it's, I guess what it says something about, like, starting these things, you know, like a conversation and something starts, and we are there. We can't really complain about the, like, say, the publishing industry and how this person is not doing that. I think we have the power to also do these things, and I don't know, even when there's no money, I mean, Jalada, it's not, we don't have money to do things, but the only thing we have is ourselves and our passion for writing and books, I guess. That's the only thing that brings us together.
Well, carry on. We want to see what you come up with. We'll be watching. Thank you.
But our hope is to get to, like, to expand beyond just having a lot of people from Kenya on.
Yeah,
you know, like,
exactly. That's
and Edwidge, for example, and you know, all those. She's going to bring all the francophone into the group.
And also just even an accessibility thing. Exactly. Like, I mean, I know one of my personal dreams is to have, like, if Jalada in 10 years has, like, a press that they're printing. Like, we're actually printing our own. Not, we don't have to go to anywhere else. We don't have to, like, call some guy in India to, like, find a da-da-da-da-da. Like, if magically we got millions of dollars and we could build a printing press in Kenya that could actually print high-quality books, hopefully cheaper. So
would it take millions of dollars? I guess we'd have to figure that out.
We'll find out.
I have no idea.
Millions wouldn't hurt, though, right?
I mean, it wouldn't hurt. But, like, having our own internal press, our own internal this, if it's all there, having a space like a Jalada house. I mean, that's something I remember Nubu was talking about a lot, having a residency space.
You know what? I think this video could be for your Kickstarter campaign.
We don't have money to pay you, but
I can give you this video. You can put it online. And you need millions of dollars for your printing press.
All of the millions.
But maybe at some point having a festival, like some kind of workshop. Just
the Jalada Festival.
The Jalada Creative Writing
Sounds
School.
Nice, doesn't it? There's a music to it.
Nice.
I think as a writer, maybe I can speak as a writer as well.
Yes.
Because I remember before I joined Jalada, I was always planning to write. Like, because of work and everything, there's just so much to do. And I had some crazy schedule. And I wasn't disciplined, you know. I wasn't disciplined. But Jalada being there kind of, like, made me, because there's somewhere for me to send my work. I started writing. And I remember the story I sent in for Africa 39 was... a story I sent to Jalada.
Yes.
And then after Africa 39, I sent that story to another place. And, you know, I don't know, it's also, like, as a writer, it's really helped to know there's a place that you can access, that, you know, mm-hmm. you don't have to go through, I don't know, so many, you know.
Channel.
Yeah, so there's a place for you to send. And it's not your blog, because... You don't have so many readers in your blog. You want the whole of Africa to read on the whole of the Wall Street. So it helps having it there.
Yeah.
Keeps you writing.
And even to know that your work is appearing.
Exactly.
With, like, you're like, oh, I'm in the same anthology that Ivor Hartmann wrote.
Like,
you know.
Yeah,
it's listen, Aaron Beatty wrote a transcript for an anthology or we're editing. Like, to be in the company of people you respect and admire so, so much. And for them to want to be in your company. And, like, then, like you're saying, as a writer, it just makes you like, no, I have to write something for this. There's no way I'm not writing something for this.
It's also exciting how the anthologies are received. Like, when we publish, it's like the whole of Facebook and Twitter.
It's going crazy.
Yeah, and we receive quite huge views, many, many views. On the first day of publishing, it's like anything from 7,000 to 15,000 and on a single day. That's
and this is all through your personal networks, right?
Yeah.
And it's expanding
that
way.
That's the other thing,
yeah. Because when it's coming out, everybody is ready to share, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we announce that it's coming out and everybody's tweeting that there's a Jalada anthology coming. Mm-hmm. And it's exciting to have done all that work, all these sleepless nights, and you see people appreciate, and it's
You were about to say something about like the personal networks.
No, I was saying it's the same thing, you know, like we say, like we all bring in our small, you know,
little
things
groups.
Into, and I think network is one of the things, you know, like the way I don't know who we were talking with in the bus and said, I know somebody who can translate something into whatever,
yes.
we'll put you in touch with this person, and I know they will do it for you, even if you don't have money. And that's, you know, like everybody knows this person and this other person to get to.
And even more than even beyond the writers, because like Razia, who does a lot of the design work for Jalada, like so each story
and
had its individual
and
art.
She has to read through that
and
interpret the story, you know, visually, artistically, you know, it's, the interpretation that she gives to each story is just so
it's flawless. Like you read your own piece and you see her thing, you're like, yep,
that's what I had in mind.
Thank you. And you like and gallery quality work, which I'm like, if you put it up, you could sell it. It's gorgeous.
Yeah.
And like an artist, my friend Nadia, drew the cover for the last edition. He was just like, hey, do you want to draw something for Jalada? Yeah, that's so cool. And she like drew some gorgeous images and artists, web designers.
And soon after that, there were people asking if they could use the image, and it's been used in the festival. Like
it's a flag image.
That happened here like 2 weeks ago.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I think passion is really appealing to people, you know? When you guys are very passionate about what you're doing, it generates energy, it generates an energy people want to be part of, and then it just builds on itself, you know? You keep adding more creative energy to the pot. It's really exciting.
Yeah. I hope we have this energy that we have for it, like 10 years.
I know, right?
You know, we've not all killed each other. We want when the money comes.
You'll be multimillionaires.
Yeah, like, we forget. I really hope we never forget, you know, like why we started the whole thing. And
I'll be here to remind you
Please do.
And one of the good things that's happened is because it's such a collective space and everyone has so many different skills, we've all had moments where you're 100% in, but if you need a step back for your own creative process, there's someone there to help you. There's someone to be like, okay, like I'm not editing this issue. I was telling Moses, and I'm like, no, I'm not doing it. I'm too tired. I need a break. And it's like, okay, fine. And there was enough people there. Like you don't feel this pressure. Like if I don't do this myself, it'll be horrible.
Collapse.
It's like, no, if you need to step away for a year, if you've got into a fellowship somewhere and everyone is so happy for you, if you got like a grant something or there's an idea that you just want to work on and you just need time, you can step away because there's enough of a collective energy that it's okay. No one's gonna die because you're not the one doing everything. And I think that there's a lot of pressure on a lot of people who are in publishing and in editing who feel as if I don't fix this,
it's all on your shoulders.
You can't. You just physically can't. So that I think that's been one of the good things about this.
Well, to me, it seems very special and very rare to find that kind of a group that's supportive and collaborative and generating really good work, you know? So, congratulations.
Thank you.
We will tell them. Yeah. I don't even think like people like who don't get to see how people are receiving Jalada.
Yeah.
Like, say for the internet, you know, what's happening on the internet. Like, to just hear people talk about Jalada.
Yeah.
I wish we could just like record it and just send it to them.
We probably should actually.
You guys,
you have to bring a video camera like this with you.
Exactly.
Exactly. Good idea.
You need to invest in something like that.
It's true, actually. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
We'll
any last
transition
moment?
At some point, so keep.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Keep us in mind. We can walk by over there. I'll give you a copy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.